Thank you, Hillary, and thank you to everyone who is on this webinar. And thanks so much for joining us tonight. My name is Nadia Steinzer, and I'm the Eastern Program Coordinator for Earthworks, and really excited to be able to bring you Linda Farrell and Lauren Stockman as well tonight. So I'll just give a brief interview and that I mean overview, and then we'll go right into it. So for the first several years of the shale gas and oil boom, both proponents and opponents focused a great deal on the production aspect, which is why we got our big focus on fracking. And while drilling and fracking are still obviously very big concerns, we've also moved into a new phase, which is the rapid expansion of infrastructure. And at Earthworks, by infrastructure, we mean everything that supports oil and gas development as a whole. And so this includes pipelines, compressor stations, gas to liquids plants, storage, waste disposal, power plants, and more. So all of these are in effect different spokes in a very big and growing wheel of oil and gas development. The industry is increasingly transparent about the need and intention to vastly increase processing and transport capacity, which they have identified, and you'll see it in the news all the time, as necessary if they're going to continue to produce and profit from oil and gas production, mostly because they need to keep getting it to market and keep getting new markets hooked into the system. So dozens of new projects have already been proposed, and many new facilities are currently being permitted and constructed. So the fact of the matter is that even if you live in a place without drilling, like I do here in New York, chances are you are affected by some kind of oil and gas infrastructure. So, and as a result, just like with the fight against fracking, which continues today, communities everywhere are responding to the projects they face, often with a desire to reduce, limit, or stop them. Each project tends to be planned, reviewed, and permitted separately, and it has all of its distinct impacts. But at the same time, many are raising the same concerns. And obviously, residents, activists, advocates, policymakers everywhere are asking many of the same questions, which is the reason why Earthworks and the Pipeline Safety Coalition have teamed up this year to conduct a series of webinars on four current issues related to oil and gas infrastructure. The two topics we've covered before have included community participation in permitting and pollution and health impacts. And in December, we will hold one on the growing problem of oil and gas waste, which brings us to tonight on November 1st. You will hear about how the public bears a range of costs brought about by pipelines and associated equipment. And these can range from air pollution to the loss of property to climate change, all of which underscore the risks of developing more infrastructure that could lock us into fossil fuel development for decades to come. Helping us understand this complex topic is Linda Farrell, the Executive Director of Pipeline Safety Coalition. Linda has over 20 years of experience working on the interactions between landowners and pipeline operators and building relationships with government and non-governmental agencies, industry, and communities. As a former farmer and educator, she brings a holistic approach to pipeline safety issues. Tonight, Linda will provide an overview of two key concerns, that is safety risks and eminent domain, and related policy and legal considerations. And joining Linda is Lauren Stockman, a research director at Oil Change International, where he researches and analyzes developments in the North American oil industry. For over 15 years, Lauren has worked as a campaigner, campaign coordinator, researcher, and author. He has also worked as a consultant with Greenpeace in the UK and Platform, and is the author of numerous reports and briefings on investor and financial risk, energy markets, and human rights related to energy development. So tonight, Lauren will discuss trends in pipeline development with a focus on the climate implications of projects in the Appalachian Basin and beyond. And with that, thank you all again for joining. Very excited to see so many people on the line. And I'll turn this over to Linda.
Thank you, Nadia. Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you for this opportunity to work with Earthworks. Very much appreciate and the partnership. As Nadia said, we'll talk tonight about the public risk and the public burden of safety and eminent domain, as well as the legal and policy ramifications in gas development and oil transportation. As Nadia said, we Pipeline Safety Coalition focuses on improving public, personal, and environmental safety. We focus on providing a high level of equal access to information to communities, government, and legislative entities, and we attempt at all times to be able to have productive and respectful conversations with pipeline operators, as well as connecting them with citizens. The photograph in this slide is a field in the front portion of my property. As Nadia mentioned, I come to this from the perspective of a farmer who moved to this property to farm 24 years ago, and discovered at the settlement table, actually, that there was a pipeline in that easement. It was a big surprise to us, and so we learned a lot. I've learned a lot since then. I was unable to continue farming due to the repeated construction in that field, and I guess that relates exactly to our topic of what is the public burden of pipelines in our environment. I'm having trouble getting this to function now. Let's see. There we go. So as a former teacher, as a former educator, I always think it's important to make sure that we discuss the terms that we're using, that everyone's on the same page. Safety can be described as the condition of being protected from harm or other undesirable outcomes, and the control of recognized hazards in order to achieve an acceptable level of risk. That's a pretty good definition to use for pipelines. It's pretty encompassing of many of the aspects involved in pipeline safety. A risk assessment is a systematic evaluation of the likelihood of harm. I'll preface now that I have a lot of information in my slides so that you can all use these as take-homes. I will not go through word by word on the slides, but I think it's important for you to have this as kind of a takeaway, and if you have any questions, I'm certainly always available to discuss. In relation to risk management, it's a concept that is not being used in pipeline safety and siting as it should be used. It's a concept, but it's not a practice in pipeline safety. I'm going to skip down a little bit to safety risks. When you're talking about pipelines, it is like an onion. You've got, as Nadia said, the human and environmental aspects, the quality of life. And quality of life, we really refer to the quality of life not only as living with a pipeline in your landscape, but also all of the processes that people go through from the time that they first learn that either there's a pipeline on their land or there's a proposed pipeline on their land, to the end of the day, either stopping the pipeline or having the pipeline become a permanent part of your landscape. It may not sound particularly like a safety risk, but as we said earlier, safety is really the attempt to keep yourself from as much as possible from projected harm. And quality of your property devaluation is, in our minds, a part of safety risk. The integrity and location of a pipeline, the design, the mapping, the regulatory segmentation by state and federal agencies, which results in cumulative impacts. And there's the redundancy of one pipe being laid next to another pipe, next to another pipe, and therefore overbuilding the infrastructure. There is a, many of you may have heard of, about the Panda Power Plant up in Bradford County that was just established. And the operators very proudly touted the fact that, that this power plant will provide power for the next 30 years. In our estimation, the safety risks, the environmental impacts, the cumulative impacts were perhaps not taken into consideration as they should have been. And of course, Laura will talk about climate change. And so before we talk about any of the factors in safety, again, as a former educator, I always start with knowing what you're talking about, being educated about what you're talking about. And as Nadia mentioned, a pipeline is not simply a pipe. It's more than a pipe. It's the entire infrastructure, as the federal code 49.192.3 explains. And it does not also, knowing the system also means that you know that there's a difference between not only the structure of a natural gas versus a hazardous liquids infrastructure, but that there is also a difference in what happens in the event that something goes wrong and there's a rupture. With hazardous liquids, it's predominantly a spill and it may or may not explode. And with natural gas, it's an immediate explosion. So your safety risks are different depending on the type of fuel that's being transported through each of these pipes. So in assessing safety risks and developing policies, it's important to know that that pipelines are categorized by what they carry and where they go. And interstate pipeline crosses, and we use the sports analogy, interstate and interstate sports with high school kids. And the end user, the distribution lines, they're all different sizes, they all carry different products, and the siting regulations vary with one exception, and that is that FERC does regulate the proposed interstate natural gas pipelines, but there's no federal agency, pardon me, that cites intrastate nor interstate hazardous liquids. So that's pretty much left up to, some would say, the operator. Some would say to state regulators. But all these things are important in being able to assess what your safety risks are and to influence policy whenever possible. Another important consideration in safety, again, there's a difference between what happens to a natural gas when it escapes from a pipe and what happens to a butane or pentane or oil or pipeline. This is a great product from our friend Paul Rubin at HydroQuest. Highly recommend him if anyone needs to do some research on what the asphyxiation, what the travel rate is for hazardous liquids in a proposed pipeline. All of these things, having all these things in your back pocket or in your front pocket when you are looking at the possibility of a line coming through your community helps you to protect your, not only your property rights, but your safety as well. So we often hear that pipeline accidents are reducing, that it's getting better every year. And in fact, I'll have to change the 220 significant pipeline spills already this year to 223 based on just the month of October alone. In 2015, there was nearly one incident a day. The hyperlink If you look at this slide where it says PHMSA data, that's a hyperlink to your ability to get any kind of data you need from PHMSA on the numbers of significant incidences, the significant incidences being defined, again, as, pardon me, as one that results in serious injuries or injury or a fatality, costs more than $50,000, releases more than 5 barrels of volatile fuels, or results in a fire and explosion. It's noteworthy that that if there is not a death, the National Transportation Safety Board is not required to do an investigation. In fact, they cannot do an investigation of the cause of a incident or a spill or an explosion. This particular graph is for gas transmission, but you can, as you see, you can search by the fuel type, by the state. You can type by the search by the type of incident as well. It's a very, very helpful. It's very helpful when you are talking to a pipeline company who is perhaps has their set of data in relationship to the safety of pipelines, and what you want to be doing is looking at unbiased data. One caveat on that is that PHMSA data is based on voluntary documentation provided by the pipeline industry. So, you know, I mentioned that hazardous liquids and natural gas tend to act differently, and I think we as a society have been talking more about natural gas. So I'd like to talk a little bit tonight about what does happen when a liquids line fails. Again, October, North Dakota, as if North Dakota doesn't have enough going on. North Dakota oil well in October spewed out 67,000 gallons of crude. To the best of our knowledge, it still has not been capped. And you can see in the photograph, in the photographs on this slide, not only the oil slick, but also the airborne blowout and that smoke that's rising. And again, that has not yet been capped. Sunoco Logistics Partners in Pennsylvania on October 20, 2016, 100 miles north of Harrisburg, spilled about 55,000 gallons of gasoline into the Susquehanna River. Again, that's only 100 miles north of Harrisburg. It's in the Susquehanna River, and so the concerns there are drinking water. Two perspectives on what you can be seeing here. The first photograph gives you an aerial view of the pollution in the creek. This section of Loyalsock had been also breached in I think it was Hurricane Andrew. This apparently, according to DEP, was a result of a pipe breaking, an 8-inch pipe breaking, because of floods and landslides during a heavy rainfall. Colonial Pipeline, just yesterday, there had been in Shelby County, Alabama, and you'll see this on the right-hand side of the picture at the top, a spill. And yesterday there was an explosion. Our understanding is that they are not related to each other. One incident did not cause the other, but one person is dead, five injured, and we're not sure how many are missing quite yet. So again, the public burden can be quite extreme when things go bad. So when we want to talk about eminent domain, we also have to talk about property rights. And I've included here some questions that we get from landowners. When is enough enough? You know, what point has the public need been fulfilled? And at what point are these just really takings? And of course, as I know Nadia can attest to, that is the jargon that's used is it's a taking when eminent domain is levied against a landowner or a municipality or a township. And one of the problems that people ask about is when one pipeline eminent domain case sets precedent for all others, what choice do we have? And how does that affect us in becoming more saturated and increasing our safety risk by creating higher consequence areas and devaluing our lands and taking away the use, the free and easy use of our lands? And when does domestic export stop being considered a domestic need? The quote at the bottom is a fellow who knows I live in a house built in 1750, and it really struck a chord. I thought he put very, very succinctly and very poignantly what the public burden is for him right now. So eminent domain has been a heavy hammer that industry has used for generations, really, for decades. And the reality is that things are changing. In May 2015, some of you may remember that Williams Transco was attempting to put a 200-mile Blue Ridge pipeline through Kentucky. Kentucky Resource Council helped form the Kentuckians United to Restrain Eminent Domain. And in a ruling that was a unanimous ruling, the use of eminent domain was denied by the courts because the liquids would be exported and would not benefit Kentucky consumers. Williams Transco, of course, appealed that, and in May 2015, the Kentucky Appeals Court upheld the ruling that prevents Williams from using the power of eminent domain. So this is a little bit of turning the tables. Where eminent domain has been used so successfully by the industry for so long, we are now seeing communities working with their municipalities and their state governments trying to use that turn that table around and use it to the benefit, rightfully so, I believe, of the community. Couple of other, and these are all links for you to take a look and get more information. I listed the New York decision by Cuomo to deny the state water quality standards permits because it does tie into the whole picture, the holistic view of why, although going to eminent domain is not the is not a preferred action by a landowner. It can be very expensive, but it can also work in a landowner's benefit. To in this case, if a landowner had been taken to eminent domain court, had decided to sign an easement, that easement becomes a permanent addendum to your mortgage, to your deed. And so if, let's say, in 2015, one had been taken in eminent domain, decided that they didn't want to risk eminent domain, and they they signed an easement, this denial of the 401, I guess in New York it's 404, permits, changes the status of whether or not this pipeline is actually going to go through. And so it impacts the landowner's decision on whether or not to consider eminent domain. In Georgia, the community en masse in the Palmetto pipeline was able to block that. In Ohio, recently, Wood County judge nixed the use of eminent domain for Kinder Morgan. In Pennsylvania, in September, a little out of chronology, but there's a lot of detail on this for you to look at later. The Supreme Court in Pennsylvania states that any use of eminent domain authority must be for the primary and paramount benefit of Pennsylvanians. And we here in Pennsylvania are using that and Article 1, Section 67 to fight eminent domain filings. In September of 2016, Act 13, which was initiated in about 2010, was reversed in the four following provisions. They were struck down as unconstitutional, and that is a very valid and very well used strategy, if you will, rationale in fighting, if you want to be fighting a pipeline, in fighting a pipeline for your civil rights, for your constitutional rights. In the fourth case here, the eminent domain privileges for use in private land for storage of natural gas were struck down. And so what we're doing here in Pennsylvania is saying that in many cases, a pipeline is a storage facility. So we are looking towards how far that decision will go. So another reason why eminent domain is, while it's a heavy hammer that's used widely by the industry, many say it's a scare tactic. Pipeline Safety Coalition started a database. We need to update this soon. But the database is a compilation of many, many organizations and citizens who have given their input as to from 2013 to the present, pipeline, whether it's natural gas or LNG or LPGs, what the status is of delaying, stopping, rejected by FERC, operators are actually beginning to withdraw pipeline projects because it gets too expensive. As a regulatory fact sheet, as I said before, regulations are different in every state. So however you're utilizing these or trying to implement safety and risk assessment, PHMSA, the link is up there, PHMSA has a state-by-state statute that will give you at least the safety regulations state-by-state. Just a quick... That section, the blue dot up there, is my home. We decided to fight the project through eminent domain in several ways. Twice we won the first time. The second time, the operator said, "Fine, we'll do what you want us to do." We saved 500 trees in that section of the land. That entire right of way could have been done in a much more environmentally friendly way. So I guess to summarize, you need to be the change that you want to see in the world, obviously. When we talked about the public burdens of human and environmental quality of life, overbuilding, redundancy. But the fact of the matter is the industry and the regulators are not doing what they should be doing and need to be doing in assessing and risk assessment in the siting process. So it is really left up to, our former Secretary of DEP said to a group of citizens a couple nights ago, it's really a shame that the communities have to be working so hard, but that's what we need. That's what it's going to take to make a change in policy and in legal considerations. And I know Lauren is going to talk about the very important climate change conversation that needs to influence and reduce the public burden of pipelines and pipeline infrastructure. So at the end of the day, another quote from a landowner in Westchester, Pennsylvania, who said at a meeting, "There's nothing American about taking a citizen's land against their will for pennies of value by a for-profit company for export." And that really says it all, that without community engagement and without local, state, and federal participation, that has got to be influenced by us as communities, as citizens. We are going to continue to bear that public burden. The last three little links there are examples of ways that, the community can participate in achieving change in regulations and engage legislators in, that activity as well. Thank you. Are you folks there?
Hi, thank you, Linda, for that presentation, and thank you, Earthworks, for this opportunity to share this material with you all. Hopefully you can now see my screen pretty well. I'm going to talk about specifically about the huge gas pipeline build out that is ongoing from the Appalachian Basin. When I say Appalachian Basin, I'm really talking about, you know, where the gas production comes from in that huge region. So that is primarily, of course, northwestern West Virginia, eastern Ohio, southwestern Pennsylvania, and northeastern Pennsylvania. So what many of you may know is the Marcellus Formation, the Utica Formation, which is one of the prime natural gas basins at the moment. First, just a little bit about Oil Change International. Some of you may know, some of you may not be so familiar. We've been around since 2005. Our sort of motto is we're a research communication advocacy organization focused on exposing the true costs of fossil fuels and facilitating the coming transition towards cleaner energy. Some of our prime kind of campaign areas have been fossil fuel subsidies. There's about $1 trillion annually in global fossil fuel subsidies right now. About $100 billion of those annually are targeted towards the production of fossil fuels, which is where we primarily concentrate our advocacy and research. We also work on international energy finance, targeting developing banks, bilateral finance and aid, trying to divert that international financial institution money away from fossil fuels and towards renewable and clean energy, trying to get access to energy for the billions of people who still don't have it, making that that energy access clean rather than from fossil fuels. Extreme fossil fuels, tar sands, fracking, and the pipelines and rail that enable production. We were very involved in the Keystone XL campaign and have been very involved in other Canadian tar sands pipeline campaigns. We've never had a fracking campaign as such, but have worked very much on, pipelines and the crude by rail system that enabled a lot of the fracked crude oil in the Bakken and elsewhere. And we also have a kind of emerging program that we call Transitions and Futures, which is sort of challenging the inevitability narrative of fossil fuel development, what we call fossil fuel fatalism. We look at the kind of outlooks and projections from oil companies like BP and Exxon and others, or the IEA and EIA, and kind of challenge that narrative, both the veracity of the projections themselves, but also their kind of lack of inclusiveness in terms of climate change, the way that they project energy based on current current outlooks rather than an outlook that accommodates our climate goals. So what I'm going to talk about today really is based on two reports that we published this year, one back in July, specifically about the Appalachian Basin gas pipelines, a bridge too far, how Appalachian Basin gas pipeline expansion will undermine U.S. climate goals, and then one we published more recently in September, the sky's limit, why the Paris climate goals require a managed decline of fossil fuel production. First, I'm going to talk about the sky's limit, which is the more recent report. If there's one thing you can say about the climate movement, we're pretty good at organizing people. And in this case here in Paris during the negotiations last winter, last November, this action, just getting people into this into this design, there was a reason, you know, people targeted this message about 100% renewables. If we're gonna meet the goals that ended up being enshrined in the Paris Agreement, we are going to have to get rid of fossil fuels. This is the language in the Paris Agreement that kind of provides the basis of what we're aiming for, the target, holding the increase in the global average temperature to well below 2 degrees centigrade, and pursuing efforts to limit the temperature increase to 1.5. And, you know, that was somewhat ramped up in the Paris Agreement compared to previous climate negotiations, because the science now shows that going beyond 2 degrees would be much more catastrophic than previously thought. We really need to stay well below 2 degrees. Two degrees no longer seen as a safe point to get to, but actually a point which we should not cross. So I'm just going to quickly run through the conclusions and recommendations of that report before going into the detail. Basically, the report finds that the potential carbon emissions from the oil, gas, and coal in the world's currently operating fields and mines would take us beyond 2 degrees C of warming. The reserves in currently operating oil and gas fields alone, even with no coal, would take the world beyond the 1.5 goal. With the necessary decline in production over the coming decades to meet climate goals, clean energy can be scaled up at a corresponding pace, expanding the total number of energy jobs. So the recommendations: no new fossil fuel extraction or transportation infrastructure should be built, and governments should grant no new permits for them. Some fields and mines, primarily in rich countries, should be closed before fully exploiting their resources, and financial support should be provided for non-carbon development in poorer countries. This does not mean stopping using all fossil fuels overnight. Governments and companies should conduct a managed decline of the fossil fuel industry and ensure a just transition for the workers and communities that depend on it. So I'll just go into a little bit of detail about those conclusions and recommendations. Basically, this is a chart of the emissions pathways that would get us to those Paris goals. So a likely 2 degrees pathway and a 50-50 chance of actually hitting 1.5. That would require, you know, I mean, it has basically one implication for where emissions can go from here on in. They've got to go down. They've got to go down dramatically. We've got to be around 50% of 2015 emissions levels in the 2030s. And for 1.5, we need to actually be at zero emissions by 2050. To stay under 2, that point will be pushed back into the 2060s. So it's pretty clear, you know, to achieve these goals, we've got to turn things around pretty quick, and building new fossil fuel infrastructure is clearly not the way to go about that. Going into some detail there about the reserves, you know, we really looked at, we used energy databases to look at what oil and gas reserves are in projects or wells that are currently producing or are being drilled to date. So, you know, with the coal, it's what's in existing mines, operating mines, but with the oil and gas, it's, you know, what reserves are there in the wells that are already in place. So when it comes to the, you know, the fracking wells, we're only looking at the reserves that are in the wells that have already been fracked or are in the process of being fracked in 2016. So what we find is, you know, to meet the 2 degree limit, and obviously we converted that oil, gas, and coal into carbon emissions. And to meet that 2 degrees point, we obviously can't burn all the coal and oil and gas that are in those mines and wells. But to meet the 1.5 goal, we could stop the coal tomorrow, and we still cannot burn all the oil and gas in these existing, currently producing oil and gas wells. So we produce this logic tree. It's pretty simple. It's not rocket science. You know, if we continue building the fossil fuel infrastructure from here on in, it really kind of ends up in one of three scenarios. With the choice. Wells tomorrow, you know, obviously they would they don't just stop producing overnight, so they go into decline over time, and we believe, you know, it's technically possible to ramp up clean energy corresponding to that natural decline. But obviously the economics are, you know, yet to fully materialize, but they're certainly going in the right direction. Clean energy investment is growing, is not only growing in dollar amounts, but the dollars that are being spent are now buying far more energy. This is a slide I've stolen from Bloomberg New Energy Finance, a presentation that was given a couple of weeks ago, and it just shows the kind of trajectory of wind and solar investment primarily over the since 2004. You know, prior to 2011, the trend that they saw was, you know, you have to spend more to get more. The money being going in. renewable energy are improving exponentially year upon year. And this kind of also speaks to that, and you know, Bloomberg New Energy Finance do an energy outlook annually, and I think came out in June. And one of the key findings they put right up front in the summary, by around 2027, new wind and solar gets cheaper than running existing coal and gas generators. So if you think about that for a minute, you know, they're saying that by the mid to late 2020s, I guess 10 years from now, it'll be cheaper to build a new utility scale wind and solar project than to run your existing coal and gas generators. So that means, you know, if we build this slew of gas-fired power plants that these pipelines are gearing up to feed, they could become uneconomic within a decade. And what that really means, or is likely to mean on the ground, is that these plants will not be run at the utilization rate that the companies proposing to build them right now are expecting. You know, they generally tend to, you know, expect to run these things at maybe 80-90% capacity. If solar and wind is coming in and providing energy at a cheaper cost, at some point in the future, whether it's 5 years now from now, 10 years from now, 15 years from now, the result will be those gas plants will be run less. Power is traded on the open market according to the cost at the time of generation, and those plants will lose out to cleaner energy sources. So again, you know, where those in those regulated markets, in those states where the cost of building plant is factored into the really led by the Marcellus. And here I'm just talking about dry, all through this I'm only going to be talking about dry gas. I know some of you may be concerned about natural gas liquids pipelines and natural gas liquids production. We've just focused here on the dry gas production here. So there's also, particularly in the Utica, we know that there's a lot of wet gas and a lot of liquids being produced also, but that's not what I'm discussing here. The Appalachian Basin will potentially drive U.S. gas production growth. The gray area at the bottom of this graph is conventional gas production outside of the Appalachian Basin, and it's pretty clear that that has been going into decline. That's been in decline since around 2010 and will continue to go into decline as we move forward. The orange area is shale gas production outside of the Appalachian Basin, and this projection, which is from Rystad Energy, suggests that, you know, that may keep growing into the early 2020s, but sometime around the mid-2020s or early 2020s is likely to also go into decline, and that really where the growth is in the Appalachian Basin, and as we saw from the previous slide, primarily in the Marcellus. And we get to a point, if this projection plays out, that the Appalachian Basin is providing more than 50% of U.S. gas production. So it's really where, you know, if we're going to avoid the climate impacts and other impacts of rising gas production and consumption in this country, the Appalachian Basin is where it's at. They need the pipelines for the production growth to happen. What I've done here is I've just taken what we call the first mile pipeline. So the pipelines that actually bring gas from the production zones. And we're looking at that takeaway capacity from the Appalachian Basin. The yellow area at the bottom is existing pipeline capacity, which by the end of this, of 2016, which we're nearly at now, that capacity should have reached about 22.7 billion cubic feet a day. We use Rystad Energy data that suggests that 2016 production will be around just over 20 billion cubic feet a day. And that's kind of averaged over the year, so it may actually be higher by the end of the year. But about 20 billion cubic feet a day in 2016. And you can see, you know, there's really just a couple of years of projected growth before new pipelines are needed to take more gas away. Now, what I've also done there is, you know, we're using kind of maximum capacity figures here when we talk about existing capacity, but of course the system never really runs at maximum capacity, or rarely does. And I think, you know, there's an expectation that it's probably at any given time running or is capable of running at somewhere between 90 and 95. So I just threw in there, you know, if we actually thought about the system as being utilized around 90%, we're actually pretty close to the system for takeaway capacity being full out of the Appalachian Basin pretty much this year or next year. So the colored lines above the big yellow block are proposed pipeline projects that are currently, most of them going through the FERC system as we speak. There's a couple near the top that haven't actually filed yet. The big one at the bottom is actually the Rover pipeline, which is 3.25 billion cubic feet a day of capacity. It's already the final EIS has been published, and the permit could come, I guess the decision on the permit could come from FERC at any time. But you can see what a difference that potentially makes to the takeaway capacity. And as time goes on, again, this is the black line is the Rystad Energy projection for dry gas production out of the Appalachian Basin. You can see the expectation for very steep growth in the early 2020s and on, and that can, you know, that can only happen if these pipelines are constructed. The other impact of that, you know, you can basically tell from the price of gas in the region that the pipeline, the takeaway capacity is tight as we speak. This is a slide I borrowed from RBN Energy, a recent presentation from RBN Energy, and they look at the natural gas, what they call the natural gas basis, the pricing in different hubs around the Northeast region compared to Henry Hub, which is generally considered the national gas benchmark price. Henry Hub is priced in Louisiana, which of course used to be the center of the natural gas production, but it's increasingly shifting to the northeast, the Marcellus. So those charts there are showing the price differential to Henry Hub, and most of them are dramatically down from the zero point. Dominion South, that's the West Virginia, that's a hub that priced around West Virginia and Pennsylvania. You can see in recent months it's been as much as over $2 below Henry Hub. And Henry Hub's been only recently gone over $2. So, the gas price that these companies are getting right now, actually in the basin, if they sell in the basin, is next to nothing. So they desperately need that pipeline capacity to raise the price that they actually get in the basin and to get their gas to market. And, of course, when that happens, they can invest in production growth and try and achieve that doubling of production in the region that is projected to happen. These are the pipelines, the first mile pipelines that we studied. And I know that there are lots of folks out there who are finding pipelines that are not on this list, and those pipes are generally distributing gas from the system into different markets, but are not necessarily taking the gas from the production areas. I wouldn't say necessarily that means that they don't have a knock-on effect on production and therefore a climate impact, but we focused our analysis specifically on the takeaway capacity pipelines. The top group are the new build pipelines. Probably a lot of you familiar with the names of these pipes. There's a lot of resistance on the ground to a lot of those pipes. Atlantic Coast, Mountain Valley, Penn East, the Constitution. Those are new build, greenfield projects, and that's where the bulk of the new capacity is going to come from, just over 13.5 billion cubic feet a day of potential capacity there. There's a handful of expansion projects also in play with it. Expanding existing pipeline capacity, some of which involves new pipe, but mostly new compressor stations, etc. But those are the key pipes that are in play to actually increase takeaway capacity from the region. And then this was the main sort of analysis of our report in terms of, can we afford this expansion of natural gas production and demand in this country if we're going to achieve the Paris goals and the climate goals that are so crucial. The red line is basically the US climate target of reducing emissions 83% based on 2005 levels by 2050. We use the EIA, the latest annual energy outlook 2016 EIA projection for US gas demand. We then translated that into emissions, including the full life cycle emissions from methane leakage, etc. And then we took that the EPA methane rule, which aims to cut methane leakage from oil and gas production by 45% by 2025. So essentially the blue block is the emissions from just combusting that gas in the power plant, and that's usually the only emissions the industry likes to talk about and likes to compare that with coal. But then you have the methane leakage emissions, which more or less double those combustion emissions. And what we found is that, even with the methane rule implemented, the projected growth in gas demand in the U.S. to 2040 would eat up our carbon budget, if you like, under the 83% reduction goal. Before 2040, we would basically be overshooting that goal, even if we weren't burning any coal or gas at that point. So we simply can't follow that trajectory, and we can't solve our climate crisis by just building out more gas. So to conclude, some key conclusions here. Meeting climate goals with minimal disruption to economy and livelihoods means planning now for the end of fossil fuel. We call that managed decline. The alternatives are either climate chaos or stranding fossil fuel assets with the associated economic and social chaos that would involve. You know, better to just manage it now rather than carry on and then see if we can solve the problem later and with the chaos that would involve. The rush to gas will undermine climate goals as emission savings are either non-existent or insufficient. The rush to gas may also land ratepayers with excessive costs for underutilized infrastructure. And finally, it's in everyone's interest to plan now for the managed decline and just transition away from fossil fuels. So thank you very much. There's my contact details in case anybody wants more information. I know Earthworks will make this presentation and recording available. But if you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer them now or happy to answer them later. There's my details. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. Thank you so much, Linda, and thank you so much, Lorne. That was terrific. Unfortunately, I think we lost Lorne's audio at a couple of points. Hopefully, that was just on a few people's end. But if folks have questions and they had missed a couple of things, feel free to ask clarifying questions. We have several questions that have come in during the presentation, so I'm going to start with those. And direct those to the appropriate presenter. If other folks have questions, please do keep asking them, and we'll continue with the Q&A for a little while until everybody's questions have been asked. The first question is actually for Linda, saying that it seems like a developer's ability to use eminent domain should be framed as a subsidy, because otherwise developers would have to pay, you know, fair market value for the land. And have you ever phrased it that way with opponents, and has that resonated with the population who doesn't like energy subsidies?
You know, that's a good question. I have not heard that argument being used, but I certainly will give that some thought and pass it along to some other folks. Nadia, actually, you might have some perspective on that as well.
Yeah, thanks. I have definitely talked with folks who, you know, have said, you know, would it be a good strategy to, you know, try to negotiate a much higher price for the land if the company wants to take it. I've never actually seen it framed as a subsidy. I don't know, Lorne, if you ever have, since you guys deal with subsidies, if the land cost of pipeline development has ever come up.
I have not seen it framed like that, but I think it's absolutely a legitimate way to frame it. Of course, with subsidies, the question is always, you know, how much and, you know, how to quantify it.
Right.
And that's sometimes tricky, and I certainly don't have a methodology to hand to try and do that in this case, but I would certainly say that it's a legitimate way to talk about it. There's definitely a cost saving that's being afforded to the company as a result of being able to use eminent domain, you know, that that's a very good question and a very good way to frame the issue. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's a really good thought. Oh, so
no, I was going to say, you know, one strategy that I can point to is with the Kentucky Bluegrass project. One of the requirements of the community was that the Bluegrass pipeline would provide each landowner with a piece of the profits. going forward in perpetuity. And that was, of course, unanimous, overridingly denied by Williams, but that negotiation, I believe, was used in the court proceedings as well.
Thank you for that. The next question is also, these were coming in, and I think as you all were presenting, so the next one is also directed for Linda. Could you briefly summarize how eminent domain might be used by landowners to their own potential advantage, you know, as opposed to signing an easement agreement? Are there ever cases in which going along with eminent domain would be advantageous?
Well, certainly there are situations where eminent domain, well, there are situations in which signing an easement is the only alternative that a landowner has, and that may be in the case of when all the permits have been issued and the project is going forward, and then you need to be negotiating, you need to be all along the way negotiating an easement that is best for you. In the case of eminent domain, as I said, my husband and I, you know, I come to this as a landowner who moved to a property to farm. I'm clearly not farming. And we did go to eminent domain the first time. We won. And we won because we knew what we were talking about, and that's what I was mentioning in the webinar. You really need to have your ducks in a row. We see legislators talking to landowners and saying, well, gee, the Sunoco Mariner project is coming through. You need to go to talk to FERC about that. Well, FERC does not regulate siting for hazardous liquids, for liquids lines. They regulate tariffs, but they don't regulate siting. And so when legislators don't even know what they're talking about, when you are talking about hazardous liquids versus natural gas and who regulates what in safety and siting, and even down to the state regulations, state by state, eminent domain is the same situation. You have to know what the legal parameters are for an operator being able to use eminent domain. If it is in the case of Sunoco, we're still questioning whether or not they are in fact a public utility based on the fact that, as I said earlier, according to Pennsylvania law, eminent domain can only be levied if a project is for the primary benefit of Pennsylvania citizens. This project clearly is not. And so if you know what the laws are, what the regulations are that could help you to substantiate fighting eminent domain, then it's worth it. That's what my husband and I did with our attorney. We knew that the operator was absent of state permits, and yet they were trying to take us to eminent domain. So I would say anyone who is being taken to eminent domain, find out whether or not that project has all of its permits. I'll refer again to Sunoco. In Pennsylvania, they are absent of all their DEP permits, and yet they are filing eminent domain with every landowner that they can come up with. They can't put that pipeline in without their permits, and to go before a judge with that information is helpful.
Okay, that's very interesting. Thank you, Linda. This next question is for Lorne. And the person asking the question says that they've seen comments that the pipeline capacity, at least in the Marcellus, is greater than production capacity over time, and is, you know, asking for clarification about that. And I think the other part of the question is also, how does that line up with the arguments that there'll be stranded assets when wind and solar become cheaper?
Thanks. So, if all the pipelines that we were looking at get built, it is, as that chart kind of indicates, you know, there is slightly more capacity than the current production projection would actually peak out at. Now, of course, that those production projections are always going up and down. So, but yes, if everything was built, that so currently looks like there would be more capacity overall in the system. But I was really talking about you know, where we are today and how the production projection cannot be achieved unless most of those pipelines are built. And I think the chart shows that pretty clearly. In terms of the stranded assets question, I mean, that's really about, you know, what becomes the least cost means of providing the energy that we need. And, you know, if in 5 or 10 years or more, you know, we've got wind and solar assets on the grid that are providing energy at very, very low cost, as they are projected to do, and in many cases are already doing so in some regions of the country, what happens is that the gas plants that are there are used less and less as they cannot compete. For example, you know, we hear a lot about peaking, you know, peak demand points. You know, for example, in the summer, in the middle of the day, everyone's cranking their AC. There's 100 degrees outside, and you know, that's when we have a kind of peak demand for electricity. If solar is if we build out enough solar, that's actually when solar is capable of its peak production, when the sun is highest in the sky. Solar will then be dumping energy into the grid at very, very low cost, and those gas plants will not be able to compete, and they won't be run at that time. So then you start having these gas plants that are only being utilized 50% of the time, or 40% of the time, or 60% of the time, where they were designed to be utilized for 80, 90% of the time. Then those plants are just not making the money they were projected to do. The gas demand is not what it was projected to be when the pipeline was built, and you start having this issue of assets that are not paying their capital costs, and that's stranded assets.
Okay, thank you for that. We have a few more questions, and we're going to definitely, thanks for everybody still hanging on, we're going to definitely wrap this up by 8:30. This is a somewhat related question to the previous one. It's for Lorne, and a clarification. I think what the questioner is asking is that in the estimates of emissions, the projections that you had for 2060, are you saying, does that include only the wells that are currently drilled, or does that include what industry's projections for drilling are? Because industry often claims that they need to drill 8,000 wells now just to maintain current production.
Yes, that's a good question. I think I was probably having some sound issues when I was explaining that. Mm-hmm. I try and explain that a little bit better. I don't have the slide up in front of you right now, but yes, what we'd estimated in the Sky's Limit report under developed reserves only includes reserves in wells that are currently either producing or are under construction being drilled, and that's globally. There was a slide there that showed the decline in oil and gas production over time if we didn't drill another well from today. That decline is gradual, but that's on a global basis. I think, you know, if you've been studying fracking for a while, you know those wells deplete quite quickly. It would be different in different regions, the rate of decline from existing production. But what we're saying is at a global level, oil and gas, you know, if we stopped drilling tomorrow, oil and gas production globally would not just fall off a cliff, it would actually be a decline over several decades, and we can actually ramp up globally clean energy within that time frame feasibly. When the industry, yes, they do say, you know, yes, we need to keep drilling to keep production at today's levels. And what we're saying is we shouldn't be keeping production at today's levels. We need to be reducing emissions, and that means we need to be transitioning to clean energy as soon as possible, as quickly as possible. We need to be declining our use of fossil fuels at a rate that is more or less commensurate with natural production decline. That is basically what that chart tried to show. But yes, it would be more complicated at certain regional or national levels. We were using a global analysis there.
Okay. Very helpful. Thank you, Lauren. And yet another question for you, and this may have also been something you discussed when we were having audio issues. This whole question of, you know, gas prices are extremely low right now, and if the companies ramp up production, you know, which is the fear from a climate change perspective, wouldn't the prices just decrease? And how would you end up in a situation with increasing supply, raising prices, and making it beneficial to drill more? Won't they just keep kind of shooting themselves in the foot? Is the gist of this question, I believe.
Not sure I understand the question.
I think it's that your projections are based on ramped up production, but as production increases, supply increases, and prices go down, and we're seeing a situation now where a lot of companies can't drill because prices are low. So how does that influence your emission scenario at all?
I think I know what you're getting at. So the gas projection that I showed is based on an expectation of rising prices. Yes. Mm-hmm. If you're able to go back and look at it, it does show a slight slower increase over the next couple of years, which Rystad sees, you know, the impact of the lower prices that have been the case for the last couple of years, but that, you know, there is an expectation there that and we have been seeing that, at least at the national level, that Henry Hub price that I talked about, you know, we were at less than $2 for much of the first half of 2016, but in the recent weeks and months it's been closer to $3. We're already seeing rigs going back out into the Marcellus and other regions, a slight pickup on the back of that. So, yes, I mean, any oil and gas projection is based on a price assumption. And if the prices aren't in line with that assumption, we're going to see a different outcome in terms of production. I think the key thing in terms of addressing, you know, meeting the Paris commitments and addressing climate change, you know, we need to be addressing it from both sides, both supply and demand. If we get to a point where the demand for oil and gas peaks and starts to go into decline, then we'll start to see a very different price dynamic than we've seen for the last 100 years, basically, 150 years. So, you know, it's a problem that needs to be attacked from both sides. We need to be, you know, but we're very clear that, we can't solve the climate issue by building more fossil fuel infrastructure. We need to be addressing the supply side as aggressively as the demand side. If we keep building this stuff, that won't actually help us address the demand side either. I hope that answers your question. I'd be happy to, if the person wants to email me and clarify it, I'd be happy to answer it in more detail if possible.
Okay, thank you, Lauren. Yeah, it's obviously a complicated situation, and I think the companies themselves may not be clear which way the supply-demand
curve is going.
Companies
are 100% committed to growth, you know, as any company is, and they have no, they don't believe, if they believe in climate change at all, they don't believe that the world will take the action necessary that will actually stem the demand for their product. Or they're not even thinking about that. They're 100% committed to growth. They've certainly, you know, went over the top and crashed the price over the last few years. But you know, money is cheap, credit is cheap right now, has been for a while, and they're committed to, you know, they thoroughly expect prices to pick up over the next couple of years. To enable this production growth that they're gearing up all this pipeline capacity to take away. I mean, mm-hmm. that's the fundamental basis of that projection, is that gas prices will rise over $3. You know, the problem in the Marcellus is that the vast amount of the gas in the Marcellus is producible at less than $5, mm-hmm. and you know. So we can't just expect the market to kind of keep that stuff in the ground. We see the fundamental strategy of doing that is to stop these pipelines being built, and then they won't be able to get the stuff out of the ground.
Right. Okay, there's a couple final questions, and I just want to say to folks, some people have put in comments and ideas, and when we send the recording and the information around, we will include Lauren and Linda's email addresses. So if you feel you need more information than we're providing here in this Q&A session, please feel free to email them. Lauren, do you know whether the projections on pipelines and emissions west of the Mississippi are comparable, and if is Oil Change doing that research, or can you recommend anyone who is?
It's not comparable. I think the data I showed in terms of the potential for growth going forward. You know, I think I showed very clearly, and the data shows very clearly the bulk of growth is going to come from, in terms of dry gas production, is the Appalachian Basin, and that's why we're so focused on it. Apart from the fact that there's so many pipelines being proposed there, that's not to say that there isn't significant activity going on in the West, and we have not studied it in great detail at this point. Earthworks are more focused there, I believe. I mean, maybe you can speak to that, Nadia. I don't know anyone who's kind of done the kind of analysis that we've done on the Appalachian Basin in the region. You know, I'm certainly aware that there's still a lot of activity there, and new pipelines being proposed and being built, Trans-Pecos and others going into Texas and Mexico, and many others. But we don't think the level of activity going forward. We know there's been a hell of a lot of activity in the past decade or so, but in terms of the actual expected production growth, we see the Appalachian Basin as really where it's focused.
Yeah, I would agree, because most of the projects tend to be out east, and there are certainly ones happening west of the Mississippi, and that's not to deny their impact, but certainly for the purposes of the broader analysis. I think one question here as well is in reference to Pennsylvania giving approval for a cracker plant. There's a lot of processing in eastern Ohio, and also well west of the Mississippi, there's a lot of processing. And so the question is, how do we evaluate the emissions impact and the projection for meeting climate goals in relation to all of that processing? And I think that's a really good question, and one that probably requires more study. Can you comment on that very quickly, Lauren?
In terms of the processing of
of gas and so on. So
talking about these splitters and other
right.
systems that are coming up.
Yeah.
We haven't studied it. I certainly think it's something that should be focused on. And, you know, we know that. I mean, you know, if we put it all together and look at liquids and you know, oil and natural gas liquids, you know, I mean, it's Texas and the Rockies are a much wetter play, as they say. And so it does require a lot more of these separation facilities that pass the stuff out into different hydrocarbons. We haven't studied mm-hmm. it. We're certainly aware that there's a hell of a lot of activity still going yep. on. And, you know, in this low price situation that they've had in the last couple of years, it's really been the Permian in northern Texas that has continued the most activity, and with the Marcellus closely behind it. So mm-hmm. we know there's a lot of stuff going on down there and a lot more to go.
Yes, it's certainly the case, and I think the person who pointed that out about processing, you know, takes us back to the original premise of these webinars, that infrastructure is quite broad, and there's a lot to consider, and unfortunately, we're going to have to wrap things up here at 8:30, but I will forward a couple of the additional comments to the presenters, and again, please feel free to email Linda and Lauren or myself, Nadia, at Earthworks, if you have additional questions. And, you know, we've looked at a really important piece of the puzzle here, and I want to just thank both Lauren and Linda very, very much for their time and their expertise and their continued work to bring these issues to light. And thank you for everyone who joined tonight. So look for the recording and additional information.
Thank you so much for putting this together.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good night.
Good night, all.